this is exactly what you want. You could encrypt your sensitive stuff, and you could not encrypt your data which goes to the GPU or something. Unfortunately, changing the MMU in a system is not so easy because it's included in the CPU core, and you don't want to change something in the CPU core. For example, the PowerPC core is nearly the same as on the Cell CPU, for example, and you don't want to have risky changes inside the CPU core. So what Microsoft actually did was they had a clever idea of just using a standard memory management unit, and PowerPC 64 MMU, for example, offers 32 bits of physical memory space. So the bits which come out of the address, bits which come out of the MMU, are more than which are required to address all the memory. For example, the Xbox has 512 megabytes of RAM, plus a bit of PCI space and here and that. So with the 4 gig of real address space, that's all you need. So you have some address bits left. And those address bits are used to control the encryption and hashing mechanism. So we see this later because it's important of some hack we attempted. So yeah, but it's actually a very flexible way because you can fully control the encryption in software. And you, yeah, it's transparent to the user space. The hypervisor handles the stuff which should be encrypted and not, and set up the page table accordingly. So, but the user space doesn't notice that the memory is encrypted. The encryption, of course, has to take place on the CPU. It doesn't make sense to have it, for example, on the Northbridge or something, because you could just sniff the bus after the Northbridge then. So Microsoft did a system where no encrypted or no sensitive data leaves the CPU. So no key leaves ever the CPU unencrypted. Every memory is considered as untrusted. So even if you can completely emulate the RAM and put there whatever you want, well, the CPU sees it as untrusted, will check the hash fails, and the system hangs. The encryption is actually implemented in the level 2 cache, so there's nearly no performance impact. Even it's a real AES which is used, but because of the structure of the cache, it can be done in parallel with the data loading, so there's nearly no performance impact on encrypted data, which is important because the gaming console, there, you pay for the speed if you develop the CPU, and you don't want to waste your speed on stupid security stuff that the game people say. Sometimes, yeah, you need to store secure data. For example, you want to revoke a system update. If you put the revocation stuff into the flash ROM as well, you could just exchange, you could read out the flash ROM before the update, after the update, and then just exchange them to downgrade again. So in order to defeat this, you need to implement on CPU storage area. So you could implement flash on the CPU, but this doesn't work too well because flash requires a special process which is too costly if you want to do it for the whole CPU. Although flash isn't one-time programmable, you can erase it and flash it, and even if you have some mechanism to disable the erasing and so on, you can still glitch a flash, and it's all not that great. So what Microsoft did was to use the eFuse technology. eFuses are electrical burnable fuses, so like some small fuses on the CPU die, and you can apply some high current to it, and it will burn, and you can sense this fuse and see that it burned. So you do, essentially, you have a one-time programmable matrix of bits which you can use for whatever you want. Microsoft uses this to revoke system updates. So if they don't want you to downgrade to a previous version of the kernel, for example, they burn a fuse and say, hey, this old version should not run anymore. And nobody is able to clear this fuse anymore because it's burned and there's no way to reconnect the fuse. It's on CPU die and not accessible from the outside. And they did that, and they had such a large number of one-time programmable bits that they could implement a very large random number per CPU, which is used as a per CPU key. So every CPU has a different key burned in, which is used to encrypt some stuff. And the nice thing is that that key never leaves the CPU. So if you get an Xbox from the store maybe, and even if we know all the shared secrets, like we have dumped the boot ROM and all of that, and we could still not decrypt some parts of it because the key in the CPU is different for each Xbox. And they are also implemented using the e-fuses because they are cheap. And yeah, the key is like 128 bits or something. So yeah, that's not a problem. Yeah, I've spoken of the update problem. Basically, this can be set as a replay attack because you use content which is signed okay. For example, a buggy kernel was back then signed by Microsoft to be okay. It later turned out to be exploitable. Now Microsoft did an update, so the kernel doesn't work anymore. So if the hacker wants to load the old kernel again, it could just replay the old kernel, and it's signed okay. But with this sequence counting they implemented using the e-fuse, I've just spoken about this, this isn't possible. So this defeats replay attack to a certain kind. Another interesting thing is how a CPU boots, because there must be a shared secret inside the CPU, which is used to decrypt the whole file system, the games, and so on. And you can't just use an external ROM like in a PC where you have a BIOS chip. You want to have a secure boot ROM, and it should be implemented, if possible, on the CPU. And it should be big enough to hold a decent algorithm. So on the Xbox One, they had a very tiny boot ROM implemented on a die, not even on the CPU, which made it possible to snoop it out. But they thought it would be enough to provide a secure bootloader. But they had to cram so much stuff into such a tiny area that they had to choose a very buggy hashing algorithm, which later turned out to be exploitable. So they didn't want to have that again. So what they did was to include a real boot ROM into the CPU this time. It's large enough, it's 32 kilobytes. That's enough to do some decent decryption, some decent signature checking, instead of the unproven, unstable algorithm which are used on the Xbox One. Of course, it costs a bit of money because it's die space, and die space is expensive, but it probably turned out to be worth the effort. Also, another thing which killed the original Xbox security was that the memory initialization wasn't secure. The memory initialization isn't as easy as it sounds. It's not like initialize some registers. No, this time in the times of so fast memory, it's more a brute force approach. So you try to calibrate some delays until the data matches, and it's really what's done. They are brute forcing delays and seeing when the data is okay and trying to find a window of operation and using the middle of that, then it also improves reliability. But it's quite a complicated process, and you want memory for that. For example, if you want to store the immediate results on something. The Xbox One didn't have that memory setup encrypted. It was just a series of instructions which were executed by the boot ROM. So that allowed to place some code in the external ROM, which could later run and so on. And, this wasn't a way for the Xbox 360. So what they did, they added internal RAM inside the CPU, 64 kilobyte in total, which is enough to do all kinds of things. And you cannot mess around with the internal RAM on the CPU because, again, it's on the CPU die, and at last, for us hackers, it's not possible to mess around with that RAM. And you can use this RAM later to store the memory hashes. I've talked about the memory hashing. Those memory hashes must be stored somewhere. And if they are stored in the external RAM, you could, again, mess around with them. But if they are stored in the internal RAM, it's much more secure. So, yeah, internal RAM, again, isn't cheap, but it's possible, and it adds quite a bit of security to the system. I'm now talking a bit about the boot process of the Xbox 360. First, it's called 1BL. It's the bootloader. It's in the internal CPU ROM. It's 32 kilobytes of code, and it does a real algorithm for deriving the keys, a secure algorithm for deriving the keys for decryption. It uses an SHA and RC4 for that in a secure way, by the way. They are using RSA and SHA for the signature check, not the crappy TEA, which they used on the Xbox One. And they already used the memory management unit to do everything as secure as possible. They have non-executable code pages even at that early moment. So if you're able, by whatever method, to make the bootloader jump to an area where it shouldn't jump, it wouldn't execute the code there. It would only execute the code from the executable code pages, which is only the ROM. So it's much more harder to exploit that bootloader because it already uses the features of the CPU. The boot ROM essentially loads the second stage boot ROM from Flash, checks the signature, and runs it then. The second stage bootloader runs from the internal RAM, and the first thing it checks is the bootloader revocation. So if a bootloader turns out to be buggy, Microsoft is able to update that bootloader and burn a fuse, and the old bootloader will check if it was revoked or not. So the bootloader includes a revocation check for itself in it. Of course, this must be done at the very early in the bootloader, because if a bug is before that revocation check, you could exploit that anyway, and it could not revoke it anymore. But it's done quite at the beginning, and yeah, that makes it quite secure. They initialize the memory. As I said, it runs in the internal RAM, so it can be done in a nice way. It initializes the external memory encryption using a real random number generator, which is on the CPU die as well. So it uses a different key for the memory encryption each time. So even if you have found out the key one time, you could then modify the memory, but because the key is changing every time you boot, this isn't possible to use it on another console then or after you reboot it. Then that bootloader loads a kernel loader into external RAM. The external RAM now is already secure because the hashing is already enabled, the memory encryption is already enabled. That bootloader then loads the kernel, and then there's an interesting thing. It can execute either the kernel directly, the kernel is stored in Flash ROM, and it's never updated. Instead, Microsoft is adding kernel patches to it. So if they update something in the kernel, which they do quite often, they do not rewrite the whole kernel. Instead, they add a patch, which is applied while the boot process. So the 4BL extracts the kernel into RAM, then executes all the patches which are stored in Flash ROM, and then jumps to the patched kernel. Of course, all the patches have to be signed as well, so there's no easy way to attack this. The thing is, part of the revocation stuff disallows booting without any patches. So it would be, at the beginning, it was possible to erase the patches from Flash and then run the old kernel, the base kernel, it's called, again. But they then burned an e-fuse, and this disallowed the possibility to run the original kernel anymore. So when there are no patches present in the Flash ROM, it won't boot anymore. This is important because we can detect this later. The kernel itself loaded, it includes the hypervisor in the lower 128 kilobytes of RAM. The hypervisor completely uses encrypted RAM for code and data. The kernel and the games, which are on this, which use the same security scheme, they use encrypted RAM for code, so you cannot overwrite the code with a DMA attack, for example, but they don't encrypt all the data. This is done so the data can be passed to the GPU and so on without the need to decrypt them first, and to make it easier for game developers because they don't need to say which data could be encrypted and which not. In general, all game data is not encrypted. The kernel and the hypervisor is, in fact, based on the original Xbox kernel, which in turn is based on a stripped-down Windows 2000 kernel. All the big stuff is removed. It's really just a tiny kernel anymore. It's about 1 megabyte of code. Yeah, tiny. The security itself is handled by the hypervisor. So the hypervisor checks the signature of the games, and if the signature doesn't match, it won't allow code pages to be executable. Only if the signature match, the code page flagged as executable. And the hypervisor is the only code in the system which is allowed to talk to the MMU, to configure the CPU. If you don't own the hypervisor, you cannot load code into memory. That's a fact. Hardware access, however, is not done through the hypervisor. All the games and the kernel and so on directly map the PCI registers into the addressable user space, so they just write into the registers for the GPU and Southbridge. This is not done by the hypervisor.